They told me to wake everybody up. So good morning. How are we doing?
Good.
All right. So Rod and Ari, thank you very much for having me come to this kickoff today. These are my official disclosures, but I do have a confession to make. That is that when Rod and Ari asked me to give this talk, I was sort of, as you remember, speechless. I was like, this is a very important talk because there are going to be a bunch of early career surgeons in the room, and they'll want some motivation. They're spending the day to try to figure out how to be a great surgeon, how to have a great productive academic life. So wouldn't you want somebody a little bit more older, maybe, a little bit more wiser? And then Rod says, oh, don't worry about it, Adil. Just say something inspirational, you're going to be just fine. So to get inspiration, I looked at lots of TED videos. And I'll be referencing these videos in the talk today. They're all very fantastic, especially about the one about how to find your life's purposes in 5 minutes. And I'm hoping that we're going to be able to do that exercise. So if you have a pen and pencil, that will be very helpful kind of in the later part of the talk. The whole problem, though, when I watched these TED Talks was that none of them really were specifically applicable to what we do as surgeons. You know, I was looking for somebody who had like a perfect surgical life. Somebody who loves what they do. When they come to work, they're like smiling in the morning. They're always talking about how great it is to be a surgeon. And so to find that perfect life, I went to Facebook, right? And I went to Facebook, and I actually asked Dr. Cameron. And I said, Dr. Cameron, I'm hoping to try to give an inspiring talk for surgeons, and I want to do a spin on your often quoted phrase, find a job you love, and you'll never work a day in your life, right? And Dr. Cameron always says this, and if you see him, you'll realize, you know, he's 80 plus years old, he still operates, still does local procedures, and is still completely engaged in what he's doing. He also has breakfast, or coffee at least, with his wife Doris at 5 o'clock in the morning before he comes to work every day. So, this monitor is confusing, that's why I'm sorry about that. So what has been the impact of Dr. Cameron? You know, his impact has been pretty significant across the spectrum of the country. This is just a listing of the number of chairs or program directors that he's helped train. And I would just ask people in the audience, how many of you have been trained by somebody or have been trained by somebody who's worked with Dr. Cameron? See, so like a great proportion of the people here have had something to do with this. So the question is, you know, how did he find this job where he really loved every day that he came to work? Like, how do you do that? And to figure that out, I went to the next level, which was to try to figure out something about love. Like, what is love? When you say I love something, what does that mean? And I came across this very contemporary definition of love, which I really enjoy. And that is that love equals to these micro moments of positive resonance. And what that really means is there are these moments of connectivity that you have with maybe somebody else. And that connection, if there are many of them, can lead to love. And so if you're able to connect with what you do, you're probably going to love what you do. And so how do we create this kind of a connection? Turns out that not everybody in America is really connected with what they do. About half of us don't like our jobs. But luckily for surgeons, more than 80%, at least in the last survey, say they're satisfied with their careers. But if you peel that, you find that many community surgeons, non-academic surgeons, many of them would not recommend that their children go to become a surgeon. But it turns out that academic surgeons are much more likely to suggest that their kids become surgeons. In fact, Dr. Cameron's son, Andrew Cameron, is a liver transplant surgeon. Right? So I feel like we're poised to have this great connection with our jobs. And the reason for that is because we can have a job where we can have an impact. And over the next 10 minutes or so, I'm going to try to go through these three things which I have on this visual abstract. Andrew Brennan, who's right here, the creator of Regional Lifelines. So Andrew, this is for you.
Thank you.
And I'm going to try to go through this and try to talk about how we can create a career or life with impact. Now, why is this important? This is important because most of the people in the generation in front of me, all of you, are part of the generation that feels that they want to do something that has a meaning. Where, you know, in the 1950s and 60s, people just wanted a paycheck. Then after that, people were like, oh, greed is good, we want to make more and more money. But now folks are like, I want to do something that's important, right? I want to solve a pressing problem. And the pressing problem that Dr. Cameron solved was the mortality after the Google operation. When he started out in the 70s, mortality after Google was about 20-25%. Right? And by the time he was done with it, by the time he trained people like Chris Sonnen, who's right here, Google mortality when you were his ACS was around 4%. Right? And so that is called, you know, solving a pressing problem. So how do you and I, how do we find the pressing problem to solve? One way to do that is what's called passion match. If you can figure out what your passion is, right, and then you can match that with what you're good at, then you can have a very successful and fulfilling career. And that's why, for the next few moments, I wanted to just see if we can do that short exercise and try to map your passion. So, is everybody okay with this? Do people want to try it? Right, you want to try it? Okay, there you go. That's a nice thumbs up. You got a pen and paper? We're going to try this, okay? So there's just five questions. There are five questions, all right? And I'm going to go through each one, all right? Patrice, former president of the Correct Group. Okay, great. And I'm going to call on one person, so let somebody take it seriously. At least one. That'd be great. All right? At least one. All right, here we go. So first is, who are you? Okay? This is not a very complicated question. The answer is your name, okay? Who are you? My name is Olive. Okay? The second question is, what do you love to do? What do you love to do? This could be, I love to teach. I love to bake. I love to go swimming. I love to operate. I love solving complicated math equations. In my case, is I love to fix policy. I love to find where there are problems that can be fixed and look at those. Who do you do it for? You're a pediatric surgeon. Maybe you do it for children. You are focused on older patients. Maybe you're a geriatrician. Who do you do it for? I do it for the disenfranchised. Those are the people that I work with. What do these people want or need? What do these people need? If you're a teacher, do your students need to have better skills in the problems that they solve? In my case, it's access to better healthcare. These people need access to better healthcare. And what change do they have as a result of it? They're able to live. So if I summarize this, my name's Adam. I work on fixing policy for people who are disenfranchised so that they can have access to better healthcare and live longer lives. Right? That's my passion. So somebody, volunteer, brave volunteer, who's gonna be it? Come on. Everybody was chuckling when I said I'm gonna ask on one person, now I can't find one person. Come on, who's it gonna be? All right, who are you?
John,
okay.
I love talking to patients and students about cancer. I do it mainly for patients. These people want and need better understanding of their disease process and treatment options. And hopefully they change as a result of my giving. Hopefully they have a better understanding of what they're getting into when they're left for surgery.
That is fantastic. So you're a person who helps help patients do better decision making and so on. That's the passion that we have. All right, congratulations. See, that worked it. Great job. Thanks so much. Anybody else want to try? One more person? Somebody from the leadership, maybe? In front? You guys want to try?
Sure. I'm Chris.
I'm Chris. No, Kasol, I need to do a better job of this. Thank you very much.
But I like caring for the sickest and most desperate patients. I do it for patients with end-stage liver disease and papillary disease. What they want
you want to take care of really sick patients and help them get increased longevity and quality of life. Well, that's great. Thank you so much, Chris. So now we have Chris back. That's great. Thank you. So now the next thing with this was, after you figured out your passion, well, how are you going to get there, right? To do something big, to go out west, you needed to be part of a caravan, right? And so what you need to do is assemble a caravan of people who are going to take you to where you want to go. This is a diagram for my career development work. So it's a K-23, and don't focus on the top part, focus on the bottom table. And you'll notice that that table has a range of people. It has a quality and process of care expert. It has a patient-provider interaction expert. It has a social psychologist. It has somebody who deals with lots of numbers. And of course, it has Dave Efron, my close friend, the person who taught me really how to be a young surgeon, right? So it had all those people, and it had these very amazingly famous people. I do trauma outcomes research. Ellen McKenzie, who's now the dean of the School of Public Health at Hopkins, taught me how to do that. A MacArthur Award genius person, Lisa Cooper, who's a professor of internal medicine and internist who studies disparities, she taught me how to do disparities research. And then, of course, the person whose footsteps I try to follow every single day is Eddie Cornwell. He was our trauma chief back then, and now is the chair of surgery at Howard University and is in the intervening trauma. But it's not just those mentors and people that you meet at work. It's also the people you meet outside work in venues like this. The AAS provided me with folks who I could look to, who would inspire me, who would share their first branch with me, like Justin did, gave me Garland the first time I tried to apply. Right? These are people who told me how to help do work. The surgical outcomes club, when I wanted to figure out how to do advanced health services research, that's where I looked to. When I wanted to take care of the most vulnerable patients, other trauma folks do that, the AAST, American Association of Surgery Trauma, right? And then, of course, working on getting my, you know, funding for minorities and so on at IMHD. But really, you want to find people that you can surround yourself and then just G yourself, right? When I'm at the AAS, I'm so privileged. This is a picture from our fall from our retreat from the summer. And I just feel like I can be who I am. And once you find your people, it truly is happiness. The next thing is mastering your terrain to create new paths. And what I mean by, and I know many people have heard this before, is that you've got to be the best you can possibly be at what you do, right? If you're a translational scientist who operates on lab animals to figure out new cures, you have to be the best person who operates on. If you're somebody who does complicated statistics, you need to be the person who figures out how to do complicated statistics, right? I'll give you an example of that. This is Tolu Oyukundu. Tolu was my first ever mentee back when I was in Baltimore, right? This is when I was a brand new surgeon and I didn't have an office. People kind of forgot that they needed to give me an office when I became an attending. You know, when you go from like being a trainee to become an attending, and you're laughing, but that's kind of what happened. And so I told Tolu, who was an MPA student at the time, I was like, just meet me outside the Halstead elevators. That's where I'll find you, because I didn't have an office to give. Anyway, Tolu and I started talking. He had a backpack on, he had his computer. We started looking at data sets. And he says, you know, there's this big issue with like missing data in these data sets, right? And so doesn't that, I just learned in class, that's a big problem. And I said, yes, that is a big problem. And I've heard of this thing called computation, where you can help figure that out. But I don't know how to do it. You want to figure out how to do it. And Tolu, of course, went and figured all that out and then wrote this paper you see here on how to use imputation in trauma disparity research. Tolu then was great at every single research piece that he took and became a fantastic methodologist. By the time he, after being an international medical graduate who did an MPH, he went to surgical residency, he graduated from Howard. When he graduated from Howard University residency program, he was the first resident in 23 years to match into pediatric surgery. And that's how it's called medical. 63 publications went, right? And mostly because he was a great methodologist and people would come to him to help figure out how to do their work. Now, how do you apply this in the real world? Last year, the AAS and SUS together did this qualitative research and presented it at the 2016 meeting where they looked at what it takes to educate a surgeon scientist. And there's actually a top 10 list from the chairs. And if you look at this top 10 list, you'll see that it closely tracks with what those people said in those TED Talks, right? What they said, what the chair said, that the people who are successful, they have this passion. They're able to create a caravan and collaborate and have teamwork. And in many instances, they have formal research training and a track record of publications. I think they're excellent and they've mastered what they do, right? And similarly, if you look at the top 10 list from the trainees, you'll find a very similar pattern. That they mostly, you know, they figured out that they can work hard and become masters of their trade. They figured out that they could find really their passion, but mostly what they wanted that parent. They wanted that mentor, they wanted that support from their institution to be able to make a difference. Now, in closing, before I finish, I want to give kudos to the person who gave this kickoff lecture last year, right? And he used no visual aids, right? And he didn't even wear a tie. And what he said were these five things which I thought were very remarkable in how once you figure out your passion, once you have your people, and once you're on that pathway to have a great job, what you can do to make sure you're successful in that great job, right? And those were, you know, do the job that you were hired to do, okay? If you're supposed to create a high-tech program, go create the high-tech program. Look for gaps, because you love to teach, but there's always already a fantastic residence program director. Focus on other things. Focus on training the PAs. Focus on other student educations. Fill the gaps. The next thing you talk about is choose your efforts carefully. You know, there's only so much time you have. So if you can figure out what your passion is, right, and focus on things that are moving your passion forward, right, creating that passion match, then you can be very successful. And then, of course, just what we want our chief residents to do, right? We want our residents to not just say, well, this is the problem. We want to hear the solutions. Present the solutions. And then finally, again, that pyramid, right? Support your colleagues. So I hope that, in this about 15, 20 minutes, I was able to, you know, bring this together on how you can find a job you love and then arrive at a job that has value for you.